Welcome to Our Grace Family. Thank you for joining us. I'm Reverend Steve Millar, a minister here at Grace Cathedral. And this is my lovely wife, Kathy. On today's show, we have a member from Grace Cathedral who traveled from Columbus just to be with us on the show.
Welcome to the program, Annette. We're so happy to have you with us today.
Thank you for inviting me. I'm happy to be here.
Now, the show is all about sharing what God has done in your life. And we want to hear your story of how you came into the true knowledge of salvation. So can you start there?
Yeah, so I came into the true salvation, the truth, actually during COVID. My brother is a member here and he told me about the live streams. So I started watching them and the sermons were so powerful, and watching the live streams is when I realized I was not being taught the truth. Like, all my life, I wasn't taught about salvation, living free from sin, the Holy Ghost baptism. So I started watching the live streams, and after one of the sermons, I said the sinner's prayer, and that's when my life really changed. I mean, I got rid of all the music I was listening to, and it really wasn't a chore. It was very easy. I just lost the desire almost immediately. So I gathered all my CDs and downloads. And I just got rid of them all. And I started listening.
And no one told you to do that. You just felt within yourself you needed to clean house, so to speak.
Yeah. And it was just a very easy thing. It was as easy as cleaning the windows in my house. I just did it without even thinking.
You want to get rid of all the worldly music because you just want to, you know, gospel music.
Right. I just loved the music so much. And each song was like a little mini sermon to me. I was really listening to the lyrics and even the instruments, the music. And the very first song I heard was I'll Be Living in a Brand New World by the Morning Stars. And when I heard that song, it might have been the first song I heard on the live streams, but the tune was catchy and I really liked that. And I replayed it and then listened to the lyrics. And it just brought such joy. I was like, wow, this is a joyful song. And this is exactly what I want and where I want to be.
Right.
And so that song really blessed me. But all the music does. So.
And many people don't realize that our own members of Grace Cathedral write and produce our music.
That's wonderful.
And the music is amazing. And there's so much God in it. Mm-hmm. And the anointing, it makes the difference.
Yes.
Right. Yeah.
And like you said, it's like a mini sermon. Mm-hmm. You know, there's so much you can get out of the lyrics of the music.
Yeah.
Now, I want to back up a little bit, okay? And when growing up, did you go to church?
Mm-hmm. Yes, we went to church every Sunday as a family, all of us. I have three older brothers and my mom and dad, and we lived not far from our church. And that was, so we would walk sometimes to church as a family, but we were there every Sunday. But again, from birth to age 18, I wasn't taught of salvation or the Holy Spirit baptism, living free from sin. None of that was taught at our church. But we did have a godly mom, and she would present herself in that church in ways that nobody else was presenting themselves. Like, she would lift her hands and praise the Lord, and she was the only one in the church doing that. And so I would witness that as a child, and I didn't understand it. And, you know, sometimes I didn't like it because I felt like she was being maybe singled out. Nobody else was doing it. But now in hindsight, I know she had such a strong relationship with the Lord. And so, yeah, we went every Sunday.
And I know you mentioned to us earlier off camera about how she did have such a strong relationship. And could you tell us a story about the bank?
So my mom, we were grown and out of the house, and I would call her almost every day on my way home from work. But there was one evening I called her, and we were talking for a while, and then she told me this story of what happened to her that day. And she was at the bank, and my dad had dropped her off. They were just running some errands, and while she was inside the bank at the teller said to her, Mrs. Stevens, I don't want you to be scared, but we're being robbed. And right at that moment, the robber had a gun and said, everybody with their hands up. And my mom reached in her purse, because she always had a rosary or a crucifix, So she was reaching in her purse and the robber yelled at her and said, get your hands up. And she fired back and said, not until I have God in my hands. And so she was telling me this story, and I just knew at the time of the story, I wasn't saved, but I knew that that's my mom.
She had faith.
God was first. And so that was the first thing she wanted to do. And then she put her hands up.
She knew God would protect her.
Right. And he did that day. And the police came right away and the robber was apprehended. And my mom had to stay at the bank for several hours to give a statement. But
so she was a good, godly mother.
She was.
And she raised you right. Mm-hmm. But you really didn't live for the Lord, though.
I didn't. So when I was 18, I just kind of did my own thing. And I thought I was a good person. You know, I didn't smoke. I didn't drink much. I had a son. And I just kind of lived my life. And I just thought, you know, I'm going to heaven because I'm a good person. And I did not raise my son in the church, so he's not saved, but I do pray for him every day. And so it wasn't really, you know, flash forward 30 years out of church, I was going to churches. I should back up. I was going to churches in Columbus and trying different churches, but I just wasn't being taught the truth. I thought I was, but it wasn't until I listened to the live streams and I was hearing things for the very first time in my life.
What were some of those things you were hearing for the first time?
Well, the two things three things, like Jesus died. I knew about forgiving for sins, but I didn't know about healing. I didn't know it was a twofold atonement there with when he died on the cross. So I didn't know about that. And I didn't know that you could live free from sin. That was the first time I ever heard that. And I didn't know about the Holy Ghost baptism.
Did you know about being born again?
I don't think I did.
Well, it sounds like you didn't because...
I don't think so, because I wasn't.
Well, you believed that you were going to heaven
right.
without accepting Jesus mm-hmm. Christ in your heart. I think a lot of people, especially people watching on this show today, think that they're going to heaven.
Right.
But they don't have Jesus in their heart, you know?
Yes.
That they're a good person. Well, look at Nicodemus in the Bible.
Yes.
You know, he was a religious leader. I'm sure he thought he was a good person, but Jesus told him, you know, except you be born again, you cannot see the kingdom of God.
Right.
So, you know, you have to have Jesus Christ in your heart.
That's right. That's right.
It's sad, but people do, you know, I was the same way.
Right.
You know, where I thought, hey, I'm going to heaven. I tell my wife all the time, you know, she would come at me with the Bible. I was like, I'm going to heaven, you know?
Yeah,
and she would say, well, what makes you think you're going to heaven?
Yeah.
Show that to me in the Bible. Mm. Being a good person makes you go to heaven.
Mm-hmm.
And I couldn't show her anything. So and I didn't know my Bible anyways.
Right. Yeah. And I didn't either. And that's what I loved about Grace Cathedral, because it's everything preached, you can take it to the Bible. It's preaching of the Bible. It's the Word of God. And if you believe in God, that's His Word. So everything in there is truth.
Right.
And so I started thinking like this, but it was because of the sermons and the ministry here at Grace Cathedral that just helped me kind of start, and the Holy Spirit too, working on me and just really shaping me and like telling me, you got to start paying attention to this. Like, you spent 30 years not paying attention, and now it's time.
Right. Right. And you know, you think about COVID and everything that was going on during mm-hmm. that time and what people were going through and mm-hmm. how we were shut in and we couldn't go to the house of the Lord to worship, but God opened the door for us to have the live streams, which was such a mm-hmm. blessing, because now we can reach people all over the world with these live streams and we're reaching people in different countries.
Yeah.
And it's amazing now that we can get the truth out in a great way. And it's so important for people to know that you have to be born mm-hmm. again, that when you accept Jesus Christ in your heart, that you must live free from sin.
Mm-hmm.
And so you didn't have that foundation.
Mm-mm. No.
So it's a new beginning for you.
It is. It really is. And you can live free from sin. Like, even some of my friends don't believe that, but I can't live free from sin if I'm not in the Bible every day doing my prayer time and having, you know, Jesus on my mind. And literally, if I wake up in the middle of the night, he's the first thought.
Right.
You know, and I don't share that with a lot of people, but he's like always on my mind.
That's because you have a relationship with them. You know?
And it all starts with the blood of Jesus, mm-hmm. because you can't have that transformation in your life without the blood. Mm-hmm. It's the blood that gives that transformation to make you a brand new creature.
Yeah.
Well, we have to take a quick break here, but we're going to want to hear how you then went on to receive the Holy Ghost.
Okay.
So friends, stay with us. We have more to come. We'll be right back.
Tabitha from Ohio shares this testimony. Acid reflux is something I struggled with for a very long time. One day during my studies, I got acid reflux really bad and I had to go to the emergency room. It was then that the doctors diagnosed it. So I went to Grace Cathedral and received prayer. All it took was just one touch from the Lord and I was delivered.
If our Grace family is a blessing to you, we'd love to hear about it. Let us know what you enjoy about the show or if a specific topic has helped or encouraged you.
And if you have a story to share about what God has done in your life, we'd love to hear it. Just send us an email. We may feature it on one of our episodes. We're back with Annette, and she let us know how she received salvation, but now she's going to let us know what happened next and how she went on to receive the baptism of the Holy Ghost. So Annette, you know, you just received salvation, and did you have a desire to go on to receive the Holy Ghost?
Absolutely. It was a strong desire. I knew after I received salvation and was born again, I absolutely had to have the baptism of the Holy Spirit. So I started seeking immediately. It was on the live streams after the sermons. I would seek in my living room, in my bedroom, during my work breaks, because I work mostly from home. So I was seeking, but I really didn't know how or even what would happen. Like, I just didn't.
Because you really didn't have any knowledge about
no
the
knowledge.
Holy Ghost. Right.
Right. I had no knowledge. I just knew I needed it.
Yeah, you had that strong desire. Now, for those who may not understand the baptism of the Holy Ghost, can you explain what you mean by you were seeking?
So while I was seeking, I was just trying to focus on Jesus and glorifying him and thanking him and just really trying to yield.
You were praising.
You were praising
Jesus,
yes.
And hoping that the Holy Spirit would come on in and take over your tongue and speak in a heavenly language.
Yes.
And that's what you were, you know, trying to yield over. But, you know, I understand. I know Kathy and I both received the baptism of the Holy Ghost. Mm-hmm. We know that, you know, it's hard to comprehend.
Very.
You know, that the Holy Spirit that is going to be living and dwelling on the inside of you and is going to give you guidance and help you in decision making, give you God thoughts, all that. Is a lot to take in, especially being born new.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you just received Jesus. You're told to go on to receive the Holy Ghost, and you know that you want him.
Yes.
But and you heard all the preaching, so you knew you were pretty much in a good position to receive.
Yes.
But you were doing it without any helpers to encourage you or anything like that because you were at home.
Right. And so that was one thing going on, and I did the best I could. I thought it would just happen because I was seeking and it was my heart's desire. And it's, you know, in Acts 2:39, it's a promise of God. Yeah. And so I just thought, okay, this is the next step. This will happen. Well.
So you're like, okay, Holy Ghost, I'm here, baptize me type of thing. But there's more to it.
There's more to it. So during the first year of seeking, you know, I would come up to Grace Cathedral here in Cuyahoga Falls and would, at the end of the service, there was always an opportunity to come down to the altar and seek the Holy Ghost. And so I would do that every time I came in person or every time at home throughout the day, night. A year went by, 2 years went by, and I just never gave up.
Did you get discouraged?
Never.
Good.
Never, ever. And I knew it was a promise of God, and I knew it would happen, so discouragement was never a factor. It was just, I had to get myself out of the way of that thought of, why isn't it happening? You know I want it. You know it's my heart's desire. I just had to forget that and know it's going to happen. You just have to keep in it. And so I would come to the in-person services a little bit more frequently. And your sister, Shelley, and Darlene, and later on, Rachel, were altar workers helping me and encouraging me and just really encouraging me to stay in that upper room. And I would seek for hours, 2 hours, 3 hours, and that would just go on. So now I'm entering year three of seeking and still not discouraged, but just the help and encouragement of the altar workers meant a lot to me because, again, I did not have the knowledge of the baptism of the Holy Spirit growing up. This was a new experience for me. I wasn't sure how to yield. I thought I was yielding, right? But
and I think that happens a lot where people were saying, yield on over, but you're thinking, well, I am yielding on over.
Yeah.
But there's more to it because self may be in the way and you have to give the Holy Spirit freedom to speak through you.
Yes.
And you have to trust in Him.
Yes.
And go ahead and just tell us your experience.
Yeah. So during that time, I learned through the sermons too that Bible fasting is, you know, very important as well when you're seeking for answers or anything from the Lord. So I did some Bible fasting here and there in the second year and the third year. But so this year, 2023, was year three of seeking. And in the spring, I told myself, I'm gonna take some time off work and really come up for the July 4th weekend services, all of them. And I'm gonna seek for the baptism of the Holy Spirit. And in the meantime, I'm still seeking at home and doing what I can. So after I decided I was coming up for that weekend, the announcement came that the Grace Cathedral, Cuyahoga Falls, was having some maintenance and the services were going to be at Grace Cathedral, Akron. And that really excited me because I went there. My mom took me there as a young, probably mid-teens. I was so excited to go back in that church. I had not been there in all those years. So I was so excited. And I thought, that's where I'm getting the baptism of the Holy Ghost. And so that was going on in my mind. And then the announcement came that the water baptism was going to happen that weekend. So I wanted to get water baptized in this church. And so the week of the services, I fasted. I just knew right away I'm going on a 3-day Bible fast. And it was, that fast was different for me. And I knew it was the Holy Spirit because not one time was I hungry. My stomach never growled. I stayed in the Word during my work breaks, after work, morning. It just felt so different. And after the third day, I still wasn't hungry, but I broke the fast. Like I was just going to do the 3-day fast. And then I just planned. I really prayed and I was praising God and I was recognizing how different everything felt. And then I came to services and you had the Friday night service and I just went for prayer and I really wanted to just focus on Jesus and really pray on just feeling the presence of God. And I did. I went to the prayer section after that Friday night service and you prayed for me and I felt the presence of God. It pulled me into my seat and that was really wonderful. And then I sought after each service on Saturday, Sunday morning, Sunday evening for hours. I was losing my voice. Shelley and Darlene and Rachel were really encouraging me. Just the words really meant so much. They were pointing out when I was yielding and that meant a lot because then I knew that's what this feels like. I was making those connections and you know, it's God's timing was just perfect because he allowed me to wait to the very last service at the very last hour, 2 hours after service. And that's when the Holy Spirit baptized me at 10:15.
Yeah. And at one point you stopped because you thought you had a long ways to go. And what happened?
So that was, So I was really getting tired and I had to stop. I just felt like I just needed to stop because my voice was crackling and I opened my eyes and Shelley was sitting in front of me. And I remember Darlene was to her left and I just said, I have a long way to go. And the look on Shelley's face was like, no, no, you don't. You're closer than you are so close. He's all over you. And that just really, I'm like, okay, let's do this. And that just gave me encouragement and the energy to go on, and it was shortly and
it
after did, that.
Yeah, it was shortly after
it
that.
Was amazing.
The Holy Spirit came in, took you over and spoke in another language.
Yeah.
And what was that like for you when he started to speak?
So when he started to speak,
you recognize the power on you right before that?
I did. Right before that, my legs, I started like shivering, like I was cold. Like it's the only way I can explain it, but I wasn't cold, but it was just that shivering. And I remember for a split second thinking, see if you can stop that. And I like immediately dismissed mm-hmm. that thought. I'm like, quit being distracted, focus. And so I just let that happen, and my legs were shivering, and
no doubt that was the quickening power of the Lord.
Yes. And so then when all of a sudden my tongue started stammering, and I just let it happen, and tears were rolling down my eyes as I was just saying glory, but it didn't sound like glory. I did not recognize what it sounded like.
So the glories were changing.
Mm-hmm. And it was, you know, in my mind when I was seeking all those years, I thought the Holy Spirit, when he takes over my tongue, I'm going to speak a language like Italian or German, and it just wasn't like that at all. It was not recognizable what was coming out of my mouth.
Yes. It was,
but in my mind, I was praising Jesus. Mm-hmm. It was just, and the tears coming down, just, I was just at that moment thinking, right now, at this moment, I'm like connected to the Godhead. I'm just like, we're tethered right now. And it was so beautiful. It was beautiful.
And I love that statement, because that's what happens mm-hmm. when the Holy Spirit comes in. You are tethered
mm-hmm.
and you have that connection now. The Holy Spirit is mm-hmm. living and dwelling on the inside of you.
Yes.
And I think so many Christians aren't being taught the importance of the baptism of the Holy Spirit. And now that he's living and dwelling on the inside of you, he can now guide and direct you in ways that he couldn't before.
Right. Yes. Yeah.
That's where a lot of Christians miss it. You know, they're living for the Lord. They accepted Jesus, mm-hmm. but they don't go the next step.
Yeah.
You know, and when you go that next step, your relationship goes to another level.
It does.
And your relationship now is so much more.
Yes.
I mean, you recognize the power of God, and the Holy Spirit's in you.
Yes.
You know, it's a glorious time.
It is.
It's just something that until you receive, you can't put it into words.
Right.
Yeah. And it's amazing.
So
your story is amazing, because your mother was connected to this ministry because mm-hmm. she would watch Reverend on television,
right.
but she did take you a few times when you were younger. Mm-hmm. So you had that connection.
Yes.
But through the live streams, the Lord brought you into the truth.
Right.
And in such a short period of time, he's really made a difference in your life.
And the other thing I wanted to back up just quickly, because this is so beautiful, is when I was that week that I came up here and was seeking, after, I think it was the Saturday evening service, after service, my brother mentioned, he goes, Annette, you went down and sat in the same pew, in the same spot that I was sitting in when I was 18 when I came here.
Wow.
Back in the mid-70s.
Isn't that something?
And felt the presence of God for the first time. And that,
there's
that
a history
was amazing
there.
To
There's
me.
A history there. It's beautiful.
Yes.
We have to take another quick break here, but friend, we have more to come, so stay with us. We'll be right back.
A love with no fault. A love so pure. Behold, what love! Mighty beyond all imagination. Behold, God's love. I'm Tabitha Matsilanzira, and this is the story behind my song. I grew up in church because my parents got in contact with this ministry in 1999, and I was 4 years old. All my life, I had been told that the Lord loved me and that he loves other people. After I really decided to consecrate myself and follow the Lord, only then, you know, did I start learning about his love, about how great it is.
A love of no fault, a love so pure, behold, what love.
Lord gave the first part of the song and a little bit of the verses when I started reading chapter 2 of Love is the Road by Reverend Ernest Angley. It was a moment in my life and my walk with the Lord where I was learning more about His love for me and His love for others and the necessity of sharing that love. And I think that's what inspired the song and that's how it came about. A love that is patient and kind. A love that laid down its own life for me at Calvary. Part of the song that talks about how that love laid down its life for me at Calvary is very personal. Without God's love, I wouldn't have my salvation. And so when I received my salvation, and it was through Calvary, so that's what that part of the song is about.
A love that is patient and kind. A love that laid down its own life for me.
The songs really come through the Lord, because I cannot on my own write music. I know this. And He uses, different ways to help us get through certain things or to comfort us in different ways. And for me, one of those ways is the songs that He gives me. I would say the way the song blesses me the most is how it's blessing other people. To have people come up to me and tell me how it's impacting them. And you know, it's worth any trial that I had to go through for the Lord to get me to that place where I needed that song. You know, just the fact that it's blessing other people for me is just out of this world.
Love that has no room for fear.
The love of God is on every mountain, it's in every valley. In every moment, we are loved, and it's God's love, and there's nothing greater than God's love.
Your love is deeper than the valleys. Your love is enough for me.
And even if you're in the valley, you are still loved, no matter how you feel. You're greatly loved by God, and that's what I want people to know when they hear the song.
Welcome back. And Annette, we want to thank you for being on the show today.
Thank you.
And we're so happy that you're a part of our Grace family.
Thank you. So am I.
I love your testimony, and I love how you received salvation and went on to receive the baptism of the Holy Ghost. Mm-hmm. Friend, what a wonderful experience Annette had. If you'd like to have that same experience to receive Jesus Christ in your heart, all you have to do is pray this prayer now and say, "Oh God, save my soul. Forgive me for my sins. Come into my heart, Jesus. Come on in, Jesus." Amen. Friend, if you meant that prayer, you have Jesus Christ in your heart. Now, I'd like to encourage you to come and be with us in the service this morning at Grace Cathedral.
And until then, we'll see you next time. Bye-bye.
This program has been made possible by the friends and partners of Ernest Angley Ministries.